Good morning. Afternoon, actually. I had just 1 hour. 1 hour was all I needed to recreate my memories with a person that time and circumstance had yanked away from my life. I was waiting at the international airport in Manila because after 10 years, she was finally coming home. My aunt would be back in the Philippines for her layover. For 10 years, we had exchanged pictures and video calls, but I knew that these were nothing compared to an hour of meeting in the flesh. The Filipino diaspora is often talked about in numbers. They are the 12% of our nation spread across the continents, the $2 billion in remittances they send home every month. But this neglects a larger part of the story, the daily sacrifices conducted in faraway countries. The stories of our overseas Filipino workers aren't just stories of success. They are also stories of invention, of finding new ways to succeed where none exist. Our clock started ticking when the voice announced the arrival of her flight. We had our faces pressed on the glass as we waited for the balikbayans, or the returnees who had come home. As soon as I saw my aunt pass through the airport gates, I knew I am lucky to have a family that can make the journey back. Not every Filipino working abroad can make the journey back home. Many of us get left behind. Many remain as TNTs, literally those who hide. They live as undocumented immigrants, playing an endless game of hide and seek with the authorities. They invent new identities, facing the anxiety that comes with hiding, fearful of being deported back home. In the United Kingdom alone, there is an estimated 600,000 undocumented immigrants who long for the lives they've left behind. I had 30 minutes left with her. The sweeping vistas of the countryside we used to visit were now the gray horizon of concrete pavement as we saw airplanes fly in and out. She will leave soon, along with the rest, to a life where she is needed, indispensable and invisible at the same time. After all, there are 500,000 seafarers of the world traveling to places as far as Malta, Italy, and the Netherlands. They will nurse you back to health as they fill the 5,000 vacancies in this country's healthcare system. And they will take care of your children when you are too busy with work, when all they wish for is to be back home with their own. Because this isn't just the story of those who leave. It's also a story of those who get left behind. These are the spouses, the children, the nephews and nieces who need to invent their futures apart. In my case, I had to reinvent ours at the terminal until our ticking clock's time had finally run out. It is an ironic fact of a migrant's life that to show someone you love them, you often have to leave. But that doesn't mean we can't invent new ways to connect, to be as much a family as ever. Because we families do what we do best. We rebuild our lives across the oceans, reinvent our ties with those we love, 1 hour at a time. Whether it's the hours we spend on Skype calls or the hours we spend with all our relatives back home for Christmas or the hours we spend praying for those who are absent, every immigrant family invents their own unique way of spanning that distance and strengthening their love. We can't change circumstance, but we can predict the future of our families by inventing it. We pick up the pieces they've left behind and invent a new kind of dream for ourselves and for them. For the last time, I saw my aunt pass through the airport gates, but this time without a heavy heart. After all, our futures can still be written 1 hour at a time.
Thank you, Johanna, for your moving speech. So, my question would be that many people who have to leave their countries for various reasons, they've been accused for not being patriotic when they should stay and form their country to be a better place. And I'm very interested about your opinion on this topic. So, should people leave their country if they're forced to, or should they always try to remain in the country and try to do it a better place, make it a better place?
So thank you for your question. To answer that, we first have to understand why many migrants choose to leave their countries. In my case, they leave because they are forced to. There's an absence of economic opportunities in the countries where they come from. So it's a bit unfair to demand that they stay back home when there are better futures for them elsewhere. And to answer the second part of your question, I don't think they're being unpatriotic. For Filipinos abroad, they tend to gather with other Filipinos celebrating parts of their culture back home. They can be patriotic without having to be physically part of the countries they come from. And that's why I believe it is, in fact, the celebration of your national identity to have your culture even when you're not there. Thank you.
Very much. Please raise your hand if you have a question.
So some countries that get a lot of immigrants, they think that their national pride is being invaded. I think that they don't want to give the jobs to the immigrants and all that stuff. So what do you think they should do? Is it okay to let the immigrants in, or should they just close their borders?
All right, thank you for your question. There's this interesting post I stumbled online. It's called Schrodinger's Cat Except for Immigrants. You know, they're accused of not having the skills, and yet they're also accused of stealing jobs. So how can you steal jobs if you don't have the skills to steal those jobs in the first place? I don't think we should be closing our borders. I think what we often forget is that many of our societies are built on the service of these immigrants. I talked about the national healthcare system in the United Kingdom. Imagine if we Filipinos just chose to come back to our country. How would we continue to provide you with nursing and other services that you need? So I definitely think that in a borderless world, there's room for us to share our cultures, provide services, and gain something in return. Thank you.
And the final question.
Specifically in the status quo in which you live, in which current presidents and the governments of the world, such as Duterte in the Philippines, Donald Trump with Mexicans, for example, would choose to give this attacks and go for the quick escape on country's trouble and go for attacking immigrants and individuals that are entering the country. That is a situation in which we cannot trust the governments, and the governments will not receive those people as their own. What do you think the common individual can do to help those people not only feel as if they're part of that country, but to develop in a world in which they can actually feel comfortable and to have the most basic necessities fulfilled?
Right, thank you for your question. It's actually very timely, since our president Duterte, whom you may have heard of, has implemented quite a ban on people who want to travel to Kuwait, given a recent incident we have with their immigration. What a common individual can do comes from several dimensions. First, many of immigrants who live also abroad can provide their services. So for example, this Sunday night, I stayed with a Filipino who heads the immigration office here in the United Kingdom. He's a lawyer, and he provides his services to other immigrants who need their help. So using our professions, even when you're abroad, can help those people, and with several other professions as well. If you're not a lawyer, doesn't really matter as much, since you can also provide other forms of support, which are just as important. Emotional support, familial support, having parades, which, by the way, Filipinos love doing here in the United Kingdom. Things like that, that's what you can do to help them feel at home.